Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Voice Mage by Jordan Rivet, narrated by Marnie Young. Let me spin you a tale of a curse. It was a powerful curse, scrawled on bare flesh by a girl desperate to save her love. Precious few curses hold such power. The cost of this curse was a deathless sleep, trapped. Its creator couldn't see her love trying to break her free. Alas, he had no magic of his own. To save her, he would have to entrust her life to another. Chapter 1. Archer drew the fletching to his cheek, trying to ignore the singing coming from the tent. He sighted along the arrow to the target, a smudge of red silk on a distant tree. He breathed, then released. His bowstring twanged, sending a vibration through his arm. The arrow went wide and thudded into the bark well to the right of the red handkerchief. "At least I hit the tree this time," Archer muttered, reaching for another arrow from the quiver on his back. Bits of the voice mage's song filtered through the scraps of canvas he'd stuffed into his ears. It made him feel lightheaded and edgy. If someone had poured liquor into his breakfast porridge, then added a whole pint of honey. He hoped that meant the magic was finally working. Esteban was the most talented voice mage Archer had ever met, but he had been trying to wake Briar up for 3 months without success. 3 months of stillness. 3 months of desperation. 3 months Archer had spent missing the young woman who had blown apart his world with a fierce look and a flick of a paintbrush. "I've never encountered a cursed sleep like this," Esteban had said when Archer grabbed him by the scrawny shoulders and begged him to heal her already. "Whatever Briar did to induce it is surely a magical breakthrough."
"So throw her a party, or do whatever you do with magical breakthroughs. I just want her back."
"As do I." Esteban had peeled Archer's fingers off his shoulders and shaken out his faded black cloak. "It will be easier to awaken her if you do not wring my neck." Esteban had tried and tried, but even his most sublime healing songs made no difference in Briar's condition. She slept on, locked in a mysterious enchantment of her own creation. Archer was beginning to despair that the old mage would never undo what Briar had done to herself. Unfortunately, Esteban could only work when they were away from camp, thanks to the licensing tattoos that tracked his magic. Their bramble-encircled hideout in Mere Woods had become a hub of illicit activity lately. Archer's merry band of outlaws had grown exponentially throughout the spring, and the woods rang with eager voices and the twang thud of archery practice. They couldn't afford to draw attention to the area with bursts of powerful and unusual voice magic. Whenever Esteban had a new idea, as he had earlier that morning, Archer wrapped Briar in a blanket, lifted her onto his horse, and carried her deep into the woods, traveling in a new direction each time. They couldn't let Esteban's magic lead the mages from the Hall of Cloaks to the rest of the band. Some might be on Jasper Lark's payroll. That morning, Archer and Esteban had ridden for an hour before setting up a tent beside the Brittlewyn River so Esteban could try out his theory. They weren't far from where Archer had first met Briar. The sun had long since passed its zenith, and shadows lay thick on the forest floor and gathered beneath the drooping trees, the perfume of spring flowers mixed with the voice magic making Archer's head spin. He brushed his thumb across the fletching of his arrow, trying to focus on the handkerchief pinned to the tree. "If only it would stop fluttering about like a drunken butterfly." The song ended abruptly. Archer tossed aside his bow and dashed for the tent. Pulling the canvas scraps out of his ears, he ripped open the flap.
"Did it work?"
Esteban slumped to the ground beside Briar's blanket, the dejection in his posture revealing the answer. Briar's hands were folded on her stomach, her large eyes closed. Archer missed seeing those hands covered in paint and those eyes staring at him with a mix of darkness and fierce light. The enclosed space shivered with magic, like the instant before a lightning strike. The hair stood on the back of Archer's neck. But Briar looked pale, cold, and far too still.
The curse is too strong, Esteban said hoarsely.
He wiped his forehead, his sleeve slipping down to reveal the faded tattoos on his arm.
It set deep in her bones when it was first painted, and I can't shake it loose. I don't know how she did it.
Archer flinched, regretting for the thousandth time that he had wiped the paint from Briar's ankle after they flew out of Lord Thane's tower and crashed into his wall. The curse had depicted a bird, but he hadn't noticed what kind or registered any other details. Maybe if he had left the curse alone, Esteban could have studied it and figured out how to break it months ago. Archer shoved down the tight coil of guilt that had taken up permanent residence in his chest and handed Esteban a water skin.
Do you want to get some rest and try again? We are needed back at camp.
The band will be fine for a day.
One day will not be enough.
Esteban sighed, his features gaunter than usual in the shadows.
Archer, I have failed.
Don't say that.
This curse is beyond my power.
Archer clenched his fists, useless rage flaring in his blood. We can't give up on her.
I quite agree.
Esteban pushed a lock of frizzy dark hair back from Briar's forehead with a gnarled hand. The action was tender, a hint that the grumpy old mage cared more for his charge than he preferred to acknowledge.
We must seek aid from the Hall of Cloaks and High Lure.
You can't be serious. The Hall of Cloaks was the center of legal magical power in the kingdom. The cloak mages administered licensing exams, tracked every spell their acolytes performed, and frowned upon outlaws for sport.
I would not suggest this if there were any other option.
Esteban coughed and rubbed his throat with a wince.
I am swallowing a great deal of pride and resentment, to be frank, and coming to this conclusion. The mages at the hall have access to extraordinary magical resources. They might find a way through this puzzle.
Are you forgetting we're fugitives from the law? Archer flung his arms wide, smacking the canvas wall of the tent. It was too small for him to pace.
I can't just turn up in High Lure with Briar. We'll be tossed into a dungeon the second we walk through the gates, and that's if my father's goons don't ambush us on the way. I'm not suggesting you take her, Esteban said. The band needs you here. This movement you have begun is fragile and requires your leadership. I can transport Briar to High Lure and petition the hall for healing.
No way. Archer knelt at Briar's side and grabbed her hand, which felt unnaturally cool, suspended between life and death. The guilt in his chest coiled tighter.
I'm not sending her away. It might be her only chance. She will never awaken if we don't try something new.
Then I'll take her to High Lure.
And abandon the team? You assembled them for a purpose, one Briar herself believes in. You must thwart Jasper Lark's efforts to expand his cruel dominion. She would not thank you for giving that up on her account.
Archer gritted his teeth.
I have to take care of her, which is what you will be doing by entrusting her to me, Esteban said. I am the right person for this task, Archer. You must see it.
Archer avoided his gaze, tightening his grip on Briar's hand. She wore the same midnight blue gown she'd had on when they reunited in Thane Castle. Archer had hoped the luxurious velvet and long sleeves would keep her warm. The fine spring weather didn't seem to affect her eerily cool skin. He had no idea whether that was a normal side effect of cursed sleep, or he was doing something wrong. Frustration roiled through him. He didn't know enough about magic to care for her properly, and he wouldn't know who to approach at the Hall of Cloaks or what magic to let them try on Briar either. She needed a mage to oversee her treatment. Archer didn't want to accept that Esteban was right. He didn't want to let go of Briar. But he had to think of his team, which had grown fast in the 3 months since they started taking recruits. Their reputation, established after a certain incident with an exploding chest of gold, was already becoming a legend. They were thieves with consciences, outlaws on a mission. Most importantly, they were the sworn nemeses of Lord Jasper Larke. They raided his supply trains, robbed his wealthy friends, and engaged in a fair bit of creative redistribution to ease the burden Larke had placed on the common folk in his lands. The recruits didn't only come from Larke's territory. People sought them out from all over the outer counties, outlaws and scofflaws who wanted to hamper Lord Larke's dangerous ambitions and earn a little coin in the process. The fact that Archer was Larke's prodigal son, striving to atone for his father's crimes, had been a useful recruitment tool. Everyone loved a family feud. The outlaws had done good work so far, but they had a long way to go to end Larke's oppression, and his dominion was expanding. He had taken control of Thane County while Lord Edwin Thane, his erstwhile ally, was in an enchanted sleep of his own. Rumor had it Larke had imprisoned Thane in the very tower Archer, Briar and Rune had escaped. Larke was now tightening his grip on the remote border counties, using the threat of Donovan Dryden's dreaded curse magic to force the minor barons to cooperate. In truth, Archer hadn't expected the burden of ending Larke and Dryden's tyranny to fall entirely to him. His methods were slapdash and underhanded, and he thought they would be temporary. King Cullum should have sent his army to resolve this mess. After all, it was his kingdom Larke was stealing, bit by bit. Archer rubbed his thumb across Briar's paint-free hands, wondering if her father was the reason behind the delay. The king used to hire the Drydens to do his dirty work, until they went too far even for him. He knew how powerful and vicious Dryden curse magic could be. Cullum might be avoiding a fight he didn't think he could win, ceding the outer counties to Jasper Larke in the process. Even with the new recruits, Archer's band couldn't hold out against Larke's retainers and hired mages forever, and they couldn't take down Dryden without Briar. They needed help from High Lure in more than one form. Reluctantly, Archer turned to Esteban.
If you take her south, can you find out why King Cullum hasn't responded to Larke's aggression? They should have put a stop to this long before now.
So he should.
Esteban rolled his shoulders, looking uncannily like a dusty vulture.
I expected my magic to ring alarm bells in the Hall of Cloaks as well. I shall try to ascertain why we are being ignored.
If the king is upset about the whole outlaw thing, remind him we're keeping Larke from gaining enough power to secede from Lure.
Archer flashed a grin.
Really? He ought to be thanking us.
Esteban snorted.
I shall pass along the message.
Briar is the priority.
Archer traced her cheek gently.
Get her healed before you approach the king.
Of course, Esteban said. We can take passage on a river boat to hasten our journey.
I'll send an escort with you as far as our contact in Marsh.
A horn rang out through the woods. Archer and Esteban exchanged worried glances and exited the tent, listening for another call. Dusk was beginning to fall. The breeze had died down, and the shadows loomed around them, ominously quiet. The forest waited. The horn blared again, nearer this time. The outlaws used bird calls to communicate. That horn could only mean one thing. An unknown force was on the move in Muir Woods. And unless Archer missed his guess, it was heading directly for the team's hideout. He gripped Esteban's shoulder.
Take Briar. Now.
Archer, no time to argue.
Archer snatched a coin purse from his belt and pressed it into Esteban's hand, feeling as though his heart were ripping down the middle.
Get her to High Lure. Find someone to break the sleep curse and bring her back to me. I'm counting on you.
Esteban pressed his lips together for a moment.
I will send word when I arrive.
Good.
Archer grabbed his bow and looked back at the tent. The flap had fallen closed, and he couldn't even see Briar. He wanted to kiss her goodbye, to hold her close, and promise they'd see each other again. He wanted to wrap her in his arms and never let go. But the horn sounded again, taunting him. The strangers were dangerously close to the hideout. The guilt Archer had carried since Briar fell asleep expanded, squeezing at his chest. He wanted to take her for healing himself. He wanted to fix this, but he had to finish the journey they'd started together. and his team needed him. He raced over to the horses and vaulted into his leggy bay's saddle. The horse snorted and danced, sensing his urgency, with a final wave to Esteban and a silent farewell to Briar. Archer kicked in his heels and charged into the forest. Chapter 2. Branches whipped at Archer's face as he rode deeper into Mere Woods. The interior of the forest felt like a living thing, all gaping mouths, reaching fingers, and glittering eyes. But he knew those woods well, and he wasn't afraid. The horn blasts came from one of the wider paths meandering through the forest. Archer followed a narrow deer run toward it. The horns continued to blare, guiding him onward. The strangers obviously weren't trying to sneak up on the hideout, but they'd crash right into it if they maintained their current trajectory. If the wrong people discovered the hideout, the authorities might deduce exactly how many outlaws lurked in Mere Woods. Lord Barden would have a conniption if he found out how large the band had grown. Archer and the team had enjoyed an uneasy truce with the local baron for a couple of months. They had delivered Rune the Stone Charmer to Barden Vale before the spring thaw, as agreed. Lord Barden had handed over Nat and a hefty payment that had served as seed money for their new and improved band of outlaws. Barden tolerated Archer's presence in his forest, pleased they shared a common enemy in Jasper Larke. His daughter, Lady May, had even helped to vet their recruits before directing them into the woods. But Archer had recently endangered this joyous union by stealing back the Stone Charmer. Rune was officially a member of the band now, and they couldn't let Lord Barden use him as he pleased. A few weeks ago, they had spirited him away from Barden Manor, along with a choice selection of riches from Barden's trophy collection. That little escapade had ended the truce and put Archer and Lord Barden back at odds, where they belonged. It was probably also why someone was heading straight for the team's best hideout. Archer spotted a large willow tree and slowed his horse to a trot. He whistled a piercing note, and Sheriff emerged from beneath the willow to join him. The big dog had been standing guard far from the tent so Esteban's magic wouldn't affect him. He sniffed at Archer's shiny black boots and cast him a mournful look, slobber dripping from his jowls. Sheriff hadn't quite forgiven Archer for leaving him behind when they searched for Rune that winter. He would have hated trekking through the frozen wilderness. The journey had nearly been the end of the rest of them. But the dog had barely let Archer out of his sight since they reunited, as if he didn't trust Archer not to leave him again. Briar's face rose before him, and he brushed it aside. I did the right thing. She'll be okay. I need to lead those strangers away from camp, Archer said to the dog. Can you warn the others? Sheriff whined and planted his haunches in the dirt. I'll join you as soon as I can. The dog didn't move. Please, old boy. I need you. Sheriff gazed at him sorrowfully, all innocence and emotional manipulation. Another horn sounded in the woods, closer this time. Archer needed to get moving. In addition to keeping those strangers away from the band, he had to make sure they didn't intercept Esteban and Briar. I'll give you every rabbit I catch for a week. Sheriff barked and leaped to his feet. He shot Archer a distinctly triumphant look and loped into the trees, his dappled gray fur blending with the dappled evening light. He'd go straight to Gemma when he reached the camp, and she'd order the evacuation. Archer continued toward the horns, considering how to play this. He knew that part of the woods well and should be able to slow the intruders long enough for the others to flee. But first, he had to assess the situation. When he reached the path, he and his horse took shelter behind a lilac bush exploding with spring colors. He had a splintered view of the strangers through the foliage. They were mounted, and most wore the signature mustard-brown surcoats of Lord Barden's retainers. Two different groups had apparently been using the horns to inform each other of their positions, and the two parties converged a stone's throw from Archer's hiding place.
"Took you long enough," said someone whose voice was all too familiar.
"Sorry, Sheriff Flynn, sir. Won't happen again, sir."
"Well?"
The sheriff of Barden County barked.
"Any progress?"
"Tracks, sir. Up ahead. We found them."
"How many?"
"The tracks were muddled, but I'd say we're looking at 60 outlaws, sir."
Archer raised an eyebrow. Only 22 people were staying at the hideout, 20 now that Esteban and Briar were on their way. He wouldn't be foolish enough to hide 60 people at a single location. Did they think he was an amateur? He eased his horse forward a few steps, trying to get a better look at the men on the road. Brambles crackled under the animals' hooves, and Archer held his breath, hoping they'd blame the wind. There were at least 40 men wearing those ugly Bardon uniforms. Archer recognized many of their faces. He had flouted the law in this fair county many a time, and he was acquainted with quite a few local goons. Among them was Pratford, the fellow who'd taunted Archer in the stocks and mud market not long after Briar joined the band. He wore a broad-brimmed hat, and his surcoat was unbuttoned. They were well outside Pratford's usual stomping ground. Sheriff Flynn must have called in reinforcements to deal with the outlaw infestation. It was official. They had overstayed their welcome in Muir Woods.
"Let's get a move on,"
Sheriff Flynn said. The big man himself wore a coat in a stylish camel color. He was too handsome to be caught dead in mustard.
"I want to make it back to Bardon Vale in time for supper."
"Yes, sir," said the nervous fellow who led the mud market contingent. "We're ready, Sheriff Flynn, sir."
The rattle of weapons being loosened echoed through the forest. Archer needed to give Sheriff more time to warn the others. But where to lead these men? He imagined the map of the forest, with its deer runs, hollows, and little streams. There was a painfully narrow corridor where it would be safe to guide the intruders without endangering the team, blocking their escape route, or compromising Esteban and Briar's departure. Luckily, Archer had excellent aim when the stakes were high. He'd thread that needle and give trouble no chance to gain a foothold here. His horse pulled at the reins, ready for a race.
"Let's do this."
Archer drew an arrow from his quiver and raised his bow. He sighted along the shaft, aiming for Pratford's hat.
"Breathe. Release."
The arrow zipped straight through the crown of the hat, knocking it from Pratford's head. As he ducked and cried out, Archer released a second arrow, which caught the nervous fellow's sleeve. His third arrow sliced neatly through Flynn's reins.
"Good enough."
Archer kicked in his heels and charged out of the lilacs, hollering as if the dogs of the lower realms were after him.
"This way, men! We'll skewer those sorry laggards and steal the coats off their backs! Charge!"
He fitted two arrows to his bow at once and shot them into the air, not waiting to see where they fell. Then he shot two more. The combination of arrows and unhinged shouting startled the men and terrified their horses. Archer galloped his bay directly between the two groups and charged into the woods on the other side of the path. Immediately, he wheeled his horse around and galloped back the way he'd come, unleashing another flurry of arrows into the milling party.
"Take them down, outlaws! Hang them from the trees by their toes! Quit your lollygagging!"
Archer crashed back into the lilacs, shouting like his life depended on it. He'd probably only get away with two such passes before someone noticed he was alone. With any luck, the sheer confusion would convince Flynn and his men that a dozen outlaws were ambushing them. Archer raced deeper into the forest, hollering encouragement to his non-existent band. He imitated different voices and accents as he shouted. With the shadows, the bedlam, and the rustling of the forest, he half convinced himself his merry band rode with him.
"After them!" Flynn's roar echoed through the woods. "The outlaw king himself is with them."
Outlaw king? Archer wasn't sure he liked the sound of that. He had no interest in kingship, and he very much hoped the actual king of Lure would come to their aid. His legend had grown bigger than he realized. An arrow zinged past Archer's ear. He ducked low to his horse's neck, smelling sweat, musk, and crushed lilac. They flew through the trees, leaping over logs and crashing through the brush. They surprised a flock of birds nesting in a squat fir tree, and the creatures exploded into the air, chattering and screaming, adding to the chaos. Voices cried out behind him.
"Don't let them get away! We're trying, sir! They're too fast, sir!"
Archer grinned. His pursuers were falling behind, tangled up in the churning woods. As he rode onward, Archer gloried in the wind in his hair, the branches thrashing against his coat, and the thud of his horse's hooves. It was just him, the road, and his enemies in pursuit. Despite everything his father had done, despite the grave importance of his mission, Archer loved this life. The only thing that would make the chase better was if Briar rode beside him. Saying a prayer to the higher realms that her curse would soon be broken, Archer leaned closer to his horse's neck and barreled into the deep green dark. Archer led Flynn, Pratford, and the others on a merry tour of the woods and only left them when they were sweaty, swearing, and far too late for supper. The darkness had thickened like ink by the time Archer reunited with the band. Sheriff had successfully delivered his warning, and Gemma and Lou had moved everyone to their backup hideout. As Archer rode into camp, the lookouts imitated birdsong to announce his arrival. This hideout was smaller than the Bramble Hollow that had been their base in Muir Woods for the past few years. Several fallen trees formed a neat little bower with just enough room for the original team to spread out their bedrolls. It wouldn't hide everyone in the newly expanded band if their enemies found them. That didn't seem to have dampened anyone's spirits. The recruits had built small campfires around the bower, and excited chatter buzzed between them. They shared food from their packs and relived their sudden flight in detail, congratulating one another on their escape. Horses snorted and stamped nearby, tied where their outlaws could mount up and flee again at a moment's notice. As Archer dismounted, Sheriff gave a joyful bark and rushed to meet him. He nosed at the pockets of Archer's indigo coat until he pulled out the rabbit he'd shot on his way back to camp. "Here you go, boy. You earned it." Sheriff affectionately covered Archer's knee in slobber, then took the rabbit and loped off to enjoy it by one of the fires. The recruits, who hadn't recognized the birdsong signal, finally noticed Archer's arrival. "He's back!" one shouted, leaping to his feet. "Archer's back!"
"He made it."
"Of course he did. He's Archer."
Archer handed off his reins to an eager young man who practically tackled him for a chance to care for his horse. He strode through the recruits, slapping backs and calling as many by name as he could, though he still hadn't gotten them all straight. He wanted everyone to feel welcome. The recruits had trickled in from outlaw bands and little villages all over the outer counties. Rumors of the team's exploits had inspired the imagination of many a young farm lad and lass. They didn't necessarily have useful skills to contribute, but Archer had resolved not to turn anyone away. These people deserved a chance to stand up to the powerful barons who'd pushed them around for too long. Archer couldn't promise the newcomers riches or longevity, but he could stand beside them in that fight.
"Were we really under attack, Archer?"
asked a fresh-faced weaver's apprentice from Thanesbury.
"I heard 100 men were heading straight for us."
"But he fought them all single-handed,"
gushed a wiry farm girl with leaves sticking to her ginger hair.
"Not quite," Archer said. "Let's keep the noise to a minimum, eh? They can probably hear you all the way in Sparrow Village."
The recruits gasped and turned to shush one another. At least that sounded a little like wind in the trees. Archer didn't think Flynn and his men would return to the woods that night anyway. While they sought their beds, Archer needed to make some decisions. He found the core members of his original crew inside the bower. When he pushed through the crackling branches to join them, no one looked surprised he had survived his latest adventure. The bower smelled of dry pine and hickory smoke. Lou was roasting nuts over a bed of hot coals, using the small iron skillet he kept in his pack. Gemma was darning a hole in her shawl, a tangle of red yarn beside her. Rune was carving something with far too many arms out of a hunk of rock, while Nat watched him avidly. The lad's shoulders had filled out during his time as a hostage in Barden Manor, and he no longer looked like a little boy. Compared to some of the recruits, he was practically brawny. Rune was bigger, though, with his bearish height and disposition, and his wild brown beard. Nat had been highly disappointed he'd missed seeing Rune's Island and all the wondrous moving statues. He'd been trying to talk the stone charmer into making a new pair of gigantic hands ever since he joined them a few weeks ago.
"I hope that wasn't a false alarm,"
Lou said, offering Archer some roasted nuts.
I had to leave a good stew behind.
Far from it.
Archer flopped down between Lou and Gemma. His stomach growled, and he tried not to think about the stew, or the rabbit he'd given to Sheriff, as he ate the nuts. Pretending to be a dozen wild outlaws could work up an appetite.
What happened? Gemma asked.
Barden's goons happened, Archer said. I met 40 of them down near the Brittlewyn.
And why in all the realms high and low did you deal with them alone?
Seemed like a good idea at the time.
Archer gave Gemma a winning grin. Their relationship had changed surprisingly little since he'd learned she was his real mother. Gemma still tried to keep him from doing anything overly rash or brash, and he kept her on her toes with his charm and youthful dynamism. Archer explained about hearing the horns in the woods and described his mad gallop through the forest, layering on the drama for good measure. Judging by the sudden hush outside the bower, he knew the recruits were listening in. They could do with some inspiration. Besides, Archer was a little annoyed Nat had transferred his hero worship to Rune, just because the fellow could make stones dance.
So, Flynn was leading this company? Gemma asked as he finished his story.
Aye, Pratford was there too.
From Mud Market? Lou asked.
That's the one.
Archer grabbed another nut from the skillet and bounced it on his palm to cool it.
Flynn brought backup. He was serious about rooting us out of here.
Nat tore his attention from Rune long enough to say,
I thought Lord Barden didn't mind us hiding out here, as long as we hit Lark's friends instead of his.
Archer shrugged.
Apparently, he's tired of us.
Yes, well, you did provoke him. Gemma tied off her last thread and held up her shawl, examining the repair with a critical eye.
You didn't have to steal his favorite treasures when you retrieved Rune.
Those treasures will keep 3 villages in grain for the next year. They were collecting dust in Barden Manor. Archer hadn't wanted to let Barden off the hook. He wasn't as cruel as Larke, but his corruption ran just as deep.
We can't lose sight of the mission, Gemma said.
Larke is our primary target.
Agreed, Archer said. I think we should cross the Sweetwater for a while.
Return to Larke County?
Lou combed his fingers through his bushy red beard.
It's risky, especially with that damn curse painter around.
The recruits who just arrived from the border saw Dryden in action, Gemma said. He afflicted a border lord's family with terrible boils. The children screamed for 3 days before the lord agreed to swear fealty to Jasper Larke. If he treats noble families that way, I hate to think what he's doing to the common folk who get in his way.
Archer grimaced, shifting on the hard ground. All the more reason to move back across the river and hit Larke where it hurts the most.
Gemma and Lou looked at each other, engaging in silent communication. They had only been married a few years, but sometimes they seemed capable of reading each other's thoughts. It was like magic.
I suppose we can't stay here, Gemma said at last. Not with the way the band has grown.
There are caves in southern Larke County, with space for all of us, Lou added.
Caves, eh?
Great idea.
Archer tossed a nut at Rune to make sure he was still listening.
Oi, how would you like to go live in a cave for a while? Your skills have been underutilized around all this mud and timber.
Rune grunted.
Was that a thank you, Archer, for offering me a chance to return to the rocky domain of my supernatural power?
If you say so,
Rune muttered.
You are most welcome, my good man.
Rune grumbled into his beard, something along the lines of,
eat dirt, moron.
Archer chuckled, ignoring Gemma's disapproving glare. The stone charmer just wanted to feel like one of the gang. Archer was happy to oblige. He teased Rune exactly as much as the rest of them. No one ever said he wasn't a generous leader.
Let's be ready to move by dawn, Archer said. And we should pick our next target.
The road heading northeast from Mud Market should give us plenty of options.
Gemma reached for a well-worn map from her pack.
It's the biggest trade route in southern Larke County. We should consider setting up multiple camps and traveling in smaller groups, though. Those rock formations won't give us as much shelter as the woods.
Archer studied the map over her shoulder.
Plus,
We won't have Esteban to sing us out of sticky situations.
What's this now? Lou asked.
Gemma narrowed her eyes. Did you offend him again?
Have a little faith, won't you?
Archer explained how he'd sent the voice mage away with Briar. If the others were surprised he'd let her out of his sight, they were wise enough not to say so. The mad dash through the woods had helped take Archer's mind off the guilt coiling around his heart like a python. He'd like to keep it that way for a while. Gemma gave him a searching look, then shook out her map.
So, we need targets too small to warrant the attention of Lark's mages. We won't want to run into them without Esteban.
Radnor, the voice mage, and Donovan Dryden, the curse painter, could make their lives very painful indeed. Larke had been hiring other mages too, especially those unencumbered by licensing tattoos, to help secure his new territories. He was moving too quickly. The fiasco at Thane Castle had forced him to begin his expansion campaign when he wasn't fully prepared, but he was making up for lost time. Archer needed to have a chat with those recruits from the border counties to find out how bad it was. He also wanted to know whether Larke and Dryden were still busy terrorizing that faraway region. If so, he could accomplish a lot while they were away. Larke wasn't the only one who could move fast.
You know what? Archer said. I don't think we should be hitting small targets.
The buzz of voices had picked up outside, a reminder that the band was already larger than he'd envisioned when he first decided to make trouble for his father. He could do a lot with numbers like this. Besides, whoever won anything by going for the smallest scores?
There's a big caravan that travels from Mud Market up to Lark Fell every spring. Let's intercept it.
How big are we talking? Lou asked.
10 wagons?
Archer sketched the route on the map with a chunk of charcoal.
It'll take all of us, plus Rune's magic, to make off with the loot.
Ambitious.
Lou twisted the buttons on his scratchy brown vest thoughtfully.
A caravan like that will be well guarded.
The small hits we've done so far aren't making enough of a difference, Archer said. We need to step up our efforts to help the people of Lark County. The folks in Thane County and the Borderlands are in trouble too. Lark won't be shy about draining them the way he's drained his own vassals.
They'd waited long enough for King Cullum to deal with Lark. Archer might be the only help the local folk would get that year. Besides, now that Briar was safely on her way to being healed, Archer could focus all his attention on the mission.
Let's talk about this caravan, then, Gemma said. I'd like to hear how you plan to use Rune's magic.
Nat leaned forward eagerly, his patchwork coat straining against his broad shoulders. Even Rune looked intrigued. He wiped the stone dust off his spectacles and turned to join the discussion properly. Archer grinned, already as pleased as if he could charm stone himself. Chapter 3 Esteban hated traveling south. It gave him a sinking feeling in his gut, as if his stomach were trying to escape the prison of his old bones. South meant High Lure, Cullum, and the Hall, and everything he'd tried to leave behind. South meant a reckoning. On previous trips to High Lure with the outlaws, Esteban had avoided the Hall of Cloaks. He'd long since grown disillusioned with the institution that asphyxiated its own magic with bureaucracy and political maneuvering. Not wanting to be drawn back in, he kept his mouth shut and his songs to himself. That wasn't an option this time. He'd have to knock on the gates and hurl himself into the maw of the beast. He always knew this time would come. No one evaded the hall forever, not even him. Esteban had used the coin purse Archer had given him to buy travel supplies in Sparrow Village and hire an extra horse to carry Briar. Given Barden Vale a wide berth, he rode to Marsh Junction, where the North Run River split to become the East Wind and the South Run. There, he sought out one of the band's contacts, an unassuming, snub-nosed woman who was an absolute shark of a banker. She was used to handling their affairs under the table and off the books. The banker gave Esteban gold from the modest stash Archer kept with her and directed him to a boatwright friend who could recommend a suitable vessel for the long journey south. Esteban disliked relying on people he didn't know well. Archer and Gemma had personally vetted their contacts over the years,
but there was always a risk they'd be sold out to the highest bidder. Jasper Lark could bid high indeed, but Esteban needed assistance if he was to refrain from using his voice magic on the journey. He didn't want to announce himself to the cloak mages before he was ready. The tattoos that swooped and spiraled around his arms linked him to the hall's infamous record room. Ever since his licensing ceremony, all the magic he performed had been cataloged there, to be scrutinized by the record keepers and monitored for illegalities. Once, Esteban had been proud of his license. He had chosen for his peers to hold him accountable for his power, and he relished the connection to the institution where he'd found his voice. But he'd learned the hard way that the vaunted accountability didn't always happen, especially when one had powerful friends. Since he'd left the king's service over 20 years ago, the link to the hall had proved troublesome for Esteban and his outlaw friends. Worse, the tattoos bound him forever to the person he used to be, a person he'd rather forget. At the boatwright's recommendation, Esteban took passage aboard a tired and battered riverboat, whose captain was more interested in coin than questions. It was unseemly for a sour old fellow like Esteban to travel with an unconscious maiden. Even the Marsh Junction banker had raised an eyebrow at the situation. Esteban told the riverboat captain that Briar was his sick daughter, who needed to go to High Lure for healing. It was close enough to the truth. Once they were aboard, the riverboat wheezed away from the docks and began the long journey down the South Run River. They'd travel through the Midland Hill counties, passing by Lou's home of Twickenridge and the rolling fields of Loxley. Then they'd carry on to the densely populated southern regions, down and down, closer to Esteban's destiny. As the riverboat creaked along, accompanied by a chorus of splashing and swearing, Esteban kept Briar below decks in their cramped passenger cabin. He couldn't have anyone questioning why she never awakened or uttered so much as a fevered murmur. Her condition fascinated him. She took no food or water and passed no waste, yet her body remained in the same condition it had been in 3 months ago. She was caught in a sort of magical stasis. Esteban had made something of a study of magical healing, but this cursed sleep wasn't an illness in the traditional sense. Briar wasn't sick. She wasn't dead. Yet he couldn't reach her, no matter what he tried. He resisted the urge to repeat the spells that had already failed, not wanting to announce his progress downriver. He passed the time writing out everything he knew of the girl's condition and every spell he had attempted so far. The notes helped organize his thoughts, which would save time when he reached the hall. The other voice mages needn't redo all his tests. He didn't want their basic healing ditties. He needed the extraordinary research and innovation of which they were all so very proud. He wrote in coal ink on parchment, the scratch of his pen filling the cabin. "The subject is a curse painter of some skill, who was known to be experimenting with skin curses. She was aware of the risks, but she is young and didn't wish to hold back. She had already achieved success with an unraveling skin curse that effectively stopped all curses directed at her, though it used an impractical quantity of marine snail purple paint. I believe this early success contributed to her rash behavior." Esteban paused and studied the girl lying on the bunk beside him. Briar's skin was waxy, and she appeared so much younger and smaller than when she was awake and wielding a paintbrush with her signature ferocity. Her breath was a mere whisper, barely audible amid the burble of the river and the shouts of the sailors. Esteban wished he could have counseled Briar not to take her experiments too far. At first, she had simply sketched designs and written down theories. By the time she got her hands on a decent paint supply, Esteban had been suffering from an infected stab wound that occupied most of his attention. The wound had ultimately forced him to stay behind and seek healing while the team continued the search for the stone charmer. Archer and Rune had explained how Briar had begun painting her hands and feet, inching along a dangerous path. She had been cautious, as far as Esteban could tell from their accounts, but a genuinely perilous situation had pushed her to risk too much too quickly. He flipped to a new sheet of parchment. on the day her cursed sleep began. The subject and her companions were in mortal peril. She had already used another skin curse earlier in her ordeal, a strength-inducing design applied to both wrists, or hands. Her companion wasn't certain. The final curse was inscribed hastily on the ankle. An eyewitness reports it was a form of ambulatory curse that transported both the painter and her companion a distance of some 40 paces at great speed. I've seen the subject execute an ambulatory curse strong enough to lift a horse across a river. I have no reason to believe this skin curse was any less potent.
Esteban chewed on the end of his feather pen, remembering the first inkling he'd had that Briar was something extraordinary. Any mediocre curse painter could move heavy objects, but the curses Briar painted on the team's saddles that day at the Sweetwater River had been masterclasses of pure control. A single twitch or flourish would change the trajectory or speed of an ambulatory curse's movements, and Briar had painted as though she was in command of all possible variations. Even more impressive, she had painted the same curse multiple times in rapid succession, with armed assailants galloping toward her. Such a feat was every bit as difficult as the flashy battle spells Esteban had used to hold off their attackers. He resumed writing. The subject was in danger when she painted the skin curse that resulted in her unnatural slumber. However, I cannot postulate that she was out of control. As noted above, she had been experimenting regularly with skin curses, and she had already displayed an unusual capacity for working under pressure. Therefore, I must conclude she knew the risks of the curse and painted it anyway. Esteban bent the corners of his parchment thoughtfully. Briar slept on, her frizzy hair spilling across her pillow. It looked a lot like her mother's. Esteban and the Drydens ran in different circles, but he'd seen Donovan and Sertia several times before encountering them at Narrowmar's stronghold. He was taking pains not to reveal Briar's identity in his notes. He didn't know if the cloak mages would recognize her, or what they would do with her if they did. Most avoided the Drydens like the plague. Esteban was still stunned that he had teamed up with the daughter of the most infamous curse painters in all of Lure. Even more surprising was the fact that he'd come to admire Briar. No, not admire. Be honest with yourself, if with no one else. Esteban adored the prickly little girl, as if she were his daughter, in truth. He could see why the Drydens had made such a project of teaching her their ways. Briar had a combination of talent and fierce determination that was every teacher's dream. Sertia and Donovan must have gloried in her magic, pushing her to stretch her limits and celebrating her every accomplishment. But more importantly, Briar had her own moral compass and the fortitude to unravel her entire life in order to follow it. Esteban knew a little something of that himself. He bent over his parchment and began cataloging everything he knew of Briar's experiments with skin curses. The painters at the Hall of Cloaks might be able to retrace her steps and figure out what had caused the cursed sleep. Perhaps the voice mages would have some insight as well, though Esteban was reluctant to admit they could do anything he hadn't already tried himself. But he would risk even that humiliation to save Briar. A knock sounded at the cabin door, startling Esteban from his work. Or maybe he'd been snoozing, slumped in his customary chair by Briar's bunk. The journey had been long, and he was often weary of late.
"We're nearing High Lure."
A sailor pushed open the door without waiting for permission.
"Pack your things and be ready to disembark with a quickness."
Esteban shuffled his notes, which had grown to a sizable stack over the past 2 weeks.
"We will be up shortly.
The captain don't hold with dawdlers."
Esteban scowled.
"Then unless you intend to carry my luggage, you'd best return to work."
The sailor muttered a creative insult and stomped away. Shouts came from above the deck, and the water rushed against the hull more insistently than before. The South Run River narrowed and sped up for the final approach to High Lure.
Esteban's heartbeat raced in response. He tucked his notes on Briar's condition into his faded black cloak, thinking wistfully of the pristine garments, all cobalt silks and silver embroidery, that he'd worn during his tenure as one of the king's official crown mages. He'd once taken pride in his appearance, but his skin had wrinkled and sagged, and his clothes were threadbare, fitting for a man who'd seen and done what Esteban had. No sense in growing maudlin. He would have to swallow his pride over the next few days. This undertaking was too important to waste time on vanity. Still, he'd purchase a new cloak before presenting himself at the hall. He shouldered his pack and wrapped a blanket around Briar's body, which was cool despite the warmth of the cabin. Esteban wiped sweat from his forehead. It was already late spring, and summer was fast approaching, but Briar's skin felt as chilled as when they'd plucked her from the snow outside Thane Castle. After a moment's consideration, Esteban fished a green scarf from Briar's satchel of belongings and tied it around her thick hair. He needn't make it too easy for anyone to recognize Saoirse Dryden's daughter. He started to lift Briar and grunted at the strain in his back. He had spent too long crouching over his notes like one of Rune's gargoyles and riding pell-mell across the outer counties with the outlaws. He was getting too old for this life. A little magic won't make much difference now. Esteban hummed a low note to take the pressure off his back so he could carry Briar in his arms. This sort of spell wasn't illegal, and he hoped it wouldn't attract notice. Hylur brimmed with magic even on a quiet day. He hoisted Briar up the boat's rickety ladder and emerged into chaos on deck. The sailors raced about, shouting and wielding barge poles like swords. Several other boats jostled theirs as the river narrowed, and the captains hollered inventive insults at one another. The riverbanks glided past, bright green and dotted with fluffy white sheep and thatch-roofed farmhouses. They weren't nearly as close to port as the sailor had claimed. Still, they were moving fast, as though Hylur were sucking them closer, eager to swallow them whole. Esteban found an out-of-the-way crate where he could sit and watch the landscape unfurl beyond the railing. Isolated houses dotted the shore, interspersed with clouds of sheep. The sailors' clamor drowned out any music that might arise from the countryside. Little villages appeared here and there, with well-worn paths leading down to the water. Soon, the houses thickened along the banks, and the emerald fields gave way to gardens tilled in neat lines. Spring flowers blossomed, and young vegetables made their colors known. Some of the houses had their own docks for fishing boats, which bobbed gently at the edge of the current. As they reached the outskirts of the city, dwellings grew like barnacles along the waterline and climbed the broad hills in waves. Gulls swooped overhead, scolding, complaining, and arguing. Beneath them, a familiar melody swelled, a mixture of wheels creaking, voices murmuring, and 100 mages singing for their supper. The distant sea crashed, providing the baseline. Esteban shifted forward, a thrill shooting through him despite his efforts to remain detached. He couldn't resist that siren song. He craned his neck for a better view, and there it was. Hylur, the golden city of his youth, where he had learned art and magic, death and betrayal, the place where he had worshipped a king who had let him down, the place where he'd once sworn he would never set foot again. Hylur was one of the world's great cities, built on a broad bluff overlooking the sea. The river cut straight through its heart and plunged in a grand waterfall to the sea below. The wind sang relentlessly against the cliffs, locked in constant battle with the roaring falls. With golden cliffs, white towers, and glittering blue water, it was little wonder this city had produced so many stunningly powerful art mages. Esteban couldn't help himself. He hummed, low and sweet, harmonizing with the music of the city. Hylur is beautiful still. Emotion welled in his chest, difficult to name, as the riverboat approached the first of many bridges arching across the river. This one, Lure Bridge, served as the city's official gateway, both a welcome and a caution to those who dared approach. Cities were not for the faint of heart. A young man could make his fortune in a city, change into something he never meant to be, then get chewed up and spit out, while the city demanded gratitude for its attention. This city was no exception. The shadow of Lurebridge slid across the boat, momentarily darkening its planks by blocking out the sun. Then they were in. On the opposite side of the bridge, the river widened into a harbor. The city rose like a layer cake around it, all high walls and grand avenues. The boats jockeyed for position at the moorings, and sailors and hawkers did the same on the broad docks lining the river on both sides. Their boat eased toward a mooring on the east side of the harbor, and the captain's shouts reached a fever pitch. Sailors dashed about, hauling ropes and barge poles as though their lives depended on it. Esteban gathered Briar in his arms, once more using a whisper of power to ease the burden. The city was rife with magic. It pressed against his eardrums and hummed along his bones. His stray notes would be unnoted here. The boat jolted to a halt, and the gangway slammed into position on the dock. After paying the river captain a little extra for his disinterest, Esteban disembarked, eager to have solid ground under him again. He carried Briar, still wrapped in her blanket with her hair covered, over to a pile of flour sacks, waiting for their ride upriver. He set her down so he could rest his back and looked about for a horse to hire. The docks were busier than he remembered, perhaps thanks to the fine weather. Fine might be an overstatement. It was hotter than Esteban remembered and muggier, too. He pulled at the neck of his cloak, grumbling under his breath. Traffic from the boats flowed past him, a dissonant clamor of stomping feet and braying voices. Esteban leaned against the flour sacks, waiting to be accosted by the usual grifters and chancers. He was obviously a tired old man with an ill girl in his charge. He should have received a dozen offers of help by now, even if they came with strings. Last time he arrived on these docks, he'd been offered 3 horse hires within minutes, and 2 carriage drivers had nearly come to blows over his business. Of course, he'd been a bit less shabby then. He really should have purchased a new cloak. A bow-legged man strode toward him wearing riding boots with a smudge of manure stuck to the heel.
"You there," Esteban called. "Where's the nearest hire stable?"
The horseman shouldered past without responding.
"I say, where's—"
"Too busy. Move along."
Esteban's mouth tightened. He hailed a sailor from his riverboat, asking the same question. The fellow acted as if he'd never seen him before in his life. Everyone appeared in a terrible rush. Had the city always moved this quickly? Esteban mopped his forehead, trying to catch someone's attention without getting out his coin purse. That would summon help quickly enough, but it would also get his pocket picked before he took 3 steps. His stomach gave an annoyed growl. When was the last time he'd eaten? He waved to a hawker selling fish pies to the well-dressed crowd coming off the boat at the next mooring. The hawker took 1 glance at Esteban's faded cloak and turned his back.
"This won't do."
Esteban had no intention of begging for assistance. His money was as good as anyone's, and he didn't look that bedraggled. Besides, it was hot, and he was hungry, and he'd expected a little more respect. He'd save his groveling for the hall. He drew a deep breath and began to sing a low, ominous song. The people around him looked up, unsure where the sound was coming from. Esteban deepened his tone and sang lyrics that hadn't left his lips for many a year. The people near him turned, their eyes going vacant. The song created an overpowering desire to be helpful in those who heard it. It was illegal, of course, but it had served him well on occasion.
"Can I help you, sir?"
The sailor who'd feigned amnesia a moment ago hurried toward him.
"Please, what can I do for you?"
asked a woman in silks. She'd just paraded past him with her nose in the air.
"You must allow me to help."
"The lass, is she ill?"
asked the fish pie seller, rushing over with his cart of wares.
"Can I offer you a free pie?"
"That's better."
Esteban stopped singing long enough to bark instructions.
You, hire me 2 horses and a litter to carry the young lady. You, get me 2 meat pies. Meat, none of that offal you're selling, and a flagon of chilled wine. And you, help me make my daughter comfortable while we wait for the horses.
The strangers blinked at him, and Esteban quickly resumed his song to ensure the orders took hold. His voice swirled around the trio, working into their minds and siphoning away their free will. They rushed off to do his bidding. More people gathered around Esteban, their eyes shimmering with concern over his well-being. He felt a twinge of shame at seeing their vacant faces. He didn't like resorting to such methods. The song was unethical at best, and as bad as a curse, if he thought about it too long. 10 minutes back in High Lure, and you're already compromising your principles. He knew this journey had been a bad idea. While he waited for his new servants to fetch the horses, Esteban studied his surroundings. Large white tenements rose beyond the docks, laundry fluttering from their windows. Many had shutters painted malachite green, a new fashion since his last visit. The elegant townhouses lining the opposite side of the river had them too. All the buildings had the familiar golden clay shingles that gave the city its distinctive sheen. And the sounds. Esteban could never resist High Lure's particular cacophony. It was more sonorous than a rackety old place like Chalkport. Even Lark's county seat of Larkfell didn't sound as melodic. Esteban closed his eyes, letting the seductive music welcome him home. Perhaps he needn't hurry to his destination. The Hall of Cloaks was in a massive keep outside the city walls, where it often appeared to be looking over High Lure's shoulder. The royal castle wasn't quite as tall as the keep's main tower, a fact that had annoyed every king for 6 generations. None had dared to cut the Hall of Cloaks down to size. Nor should they. Despite the loyalty Esteban had once felt for King Hullam, he believed the Hall of Cloaks should never fall too firmly under the monarch's thumb. Kings needed checks on their power, but so did grand old magical institutions, and the cloak mages had forgotten that of late. Or so he'd heard. It had been years since Esteban was privy to the latest gossip. He'd enjoyed a cordial relationship with Mage Fallon, who served as the keeper, the highest position in the hall's complicated hierarchy. But he didn't know whether that cordiality still held, or how the political winds might have changed. The worst aspect of being part of the hall was never knowing precisely where one stood. I could take a room in an inn for a few days, spend a little time with my ear to the ground. He touched Briar's forehead, which was as cool as ever. Her condition showed no signs of changing if he waited a few days. Esteban could find out whether the current batch of crown mages was as useless as he remembered, and how much influence the keeper currently enjoyed with King Cullum. Yes, he needed more information, and delaying would give him time to freshen up his appearance. Suddenly, there was a trill in the air, like a harp string plucked at the wrong moment. Esteban turned toward the sound, scanning the crowds on the docks for the source of the dissonance. The throng stirred near one of the avenues leading into the city. People shuffled aside, crowding closer together or slipping down alleyways, as if they'd suddenly decided those were the best routes into the city. They were clearing a path. The trill repeated, warning people to stand back. The fellow Esteban had sent to fetch horses halted in the doorway of a higher stable, twisting 2 lead ropes in his hands. He didn't venture any farther. The obedience spell Esteban had used on him couldn't overcome the one telling him to stay out of the way. Esteban moved in front of Briar and breathed deeply, preparing. Then the crowds nearest him parted, and he saw them, swirling black cloaks, expensive horses, and haughty expressions. 3 cloak mages were riding across the docks. He knew the one in the middle. Mage Fiona Bellingham had wide eyes, silver hair, and a powerful jaw on a face that was more handsome than beautiful. It was a face he'd hoped not to see on this excursion. He smoothed down his faded cloak. Why hadn't he bought new garments back in Marsh Junction? Pride will get you one day, you old bat. He was as powerful as he had been when he was the chief crown mage, the foremost servant of the king and the hall. He was as strong in wrinkles and rags as he had been in his finery. Still, he dipped his head, hoping Fiona hadn't noticed him. Appearances mattered, and he fully intended to make his petition to the Hall of Cloaks in style. The trio drew nearer, their horses' hooves striking a warning. The mages flanking Fiona were young, one male and one female. Perhaps they were her students. She was a much sought-after instructor at the Hall's art school.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.